So now let's jump back to our circle of fifths discussion, right? We've already learned how this thing works and how we can use it for closely related keys, for borrowing chords, things like that. But adding all our minor keys adds a whole kind of new wrinkle to this thing because now we have a lot more things we can do. So this particular graphic I have here is not showing us the minor keys, but a lot of them do, and I'm going to pull up one in just a minute. But I wanted to take another quick look at this one because before we look at that, there's kind of another interesting little kind of mystical thing inside this circle of fifths that I wanted to point out because it just shows how kind of complex this simple idea of a circle of fifths is. This is just kind of a neat little factoid, I guess. But in the old days, in like medieval times and after that, in the Renaissance and things like that, people taught music by using these circles all the time, not just for fifths, but for other stuff. There was a lot of different circles of this and that, and circles were a very common way to teach music. We don't use them anymore, really, except for the circle of fifths. I can't really think of any other time when we use circles, but they used to use them all the time. Anyway, check this out. So, C major. The relative minor of C major is A, right? So we slide like this. A major, the relative minor of A major, F sharp. So we slide like that. F sharp major, the relative minor, D sharp. Here let's call it E flat. And then E flat major, the relative minor, C. And so you get these kind of star patterns in here. That's not really like a thing you want to be thinking about all the time, but I think it's really fascinating how the circle of fifths shows you all these different things. Anyway, now like I said, some graphics don't show you the minors, but a lot of them do. So let's jump over to a graphic that shows us how the relative minors lay onto this graphic.